Hi everyone, and thank you so much for inviting me here. It's a pleasure, and finally being able to give a talk in person. I actually went through all of my faculty job search interview actually by on Zoom, so it's finally good to this one here. Yeah, and as mentioned, I'm Federico, a new scientist at Princess Margaret in the computational biology and medicine program. And today, what I hope to give you is mainly a taste of some of the approaches that we are trying to use and develop here in the lab, and which are all mainly focused at looking at like cancer evolution through the lens of data science and genomics, and especially at the single cell level resolution. And so we know indeed that neoplastic progression is a process of somatic evolution in which genetic alteration generate diversity. But the outstanding adaptive capacity of cancer cannot be fully explained by genetic variant alone. And so indeed, we know that cancer cellular phenotype is encoded in these multiple layers of information, which call then for a broader evolutionary model comprising both genetic and non-genetic and heterogeneity. And for instance, we know the tumor are composed of this mixture of cell, the different central phenotype, such as, for example, stemness and resistant to therapy. But these are often observed independently from genetic clonal heterogeneity. And so if you think about it, actually the notion that cancer are composed of cells that are diverse in their transcriptional state goes back a long time ago, because if you think about, like, for example, like axis of cell-to-cell variation, such as epithelial to mesenchymal transition. But more recently, the expanding of single-cell genomics to primary human sample has shown that actually this transcriptional cell state diversity is actually more ubiquitous across many different cancer types. But again, this is often independent from genetic clonal diversity. And so we think that the study of cancer actually requires the integration of multiple axes of diversity, which is basically the central mission that we have here in the lab. And some of the specific questions that we are trying to pursue here is to try and better understand basically what is the role of epigenetic alteration, mainly DNA methylation, in promoting this malignant cancer cellular state. What is their dynamic and plasticity, and what is the impact of specific mutation on this diverse cancer cell state? And so we think that human gliomas actually might serve as an instructive model to start addressing some of these initial questions that we have. And because transcriptional cell state diversity was actually shown to be an important disease hallmark, and this was shown by many groups, including seminal work by people here in Toronto, such as Gary, Trevor Pugh, Peter Dirks, Matthew Nguyen, and many others. And so yeah, I just want to touch briefly on one application of a method that we apply basically to examine the epigenetic encoding of this heterogeneous cellular state in glioma. So here we apply our multiomics single-cell method that allow integration of DNA methylation and single-cell gene expression to basically primary glioma patient sample, both IDH mutant and IDH wild-type glioblastoma or GBM. And so the first thing we did here was to actually show that our data set can actually recapitulate the diversity of cellular state that were previously reported, and this basically span more stem-like progenitor stem state state and more differentiated state that are usually associated more with the astrocyte-like or mesenchymal-like products. But now we can also use the matched DNA methylation information that we have from every single cell and start assessing what are the differences between a methylation between this transcriptionally defined cell state. And so here, basically, we show that Polycomb repressive complex 2 target, PRC2 target, were actually preferentially hypomethylated in more the stem-like progenitor state, and this then led to the activation of important transcription factor and other homeobox gene that were specifically under the control of this PRC2 complex, which is a canonical transcriptional repression. But one concept that we try to develop is that while DNA methylation changes may mark the cellular state, we and others have also shown previously that the heritable DNA methylation information may also serve as a molecular clock, which would basically reflect the number of generation in the cellular evolutionary history. Basically, as cancer cells divide, they would accrue more and more error in copying their epigenome, which is very similar, if you think about it, to the process of genetic diversification through the accumulation of genetic variants. And in addition, we also know from other studies that the maintenance methylation machinery is actually has an error rate, which is estimated to be on the four order of magnitude higher than the one for DNA replication. And so we actually think that the phylogenetic information content of single cell methylation is much higher than the one of single cell nucleotide variants. And so based on this notion, back in 2019, we built this maximum likelihood framework to try and infer phylogenies of cancer cell leveraging methylation information. And so we apply this framework now to try and retrace the evolutionary history of glioma cell. And what we see is that in IDH wild type GBM, when we projected actually cellular state onto this lineage methylation tree, we see that the distribution appeared to be quite random across the lineage tree, despite there were defined clade marked by specific copy number aberration. In contrast, we see kind of an opposite pattern when we look at IDH mutant glioma, where we saw basically a very differential enrichment of cellular state to define clade of the tree that also corresponded to major copy number variation. So we in the paper we quantify this one, but here I just want to like summarize and say that this for us is suggest a model basically in which IDH wild type GBM might be actually more plastic and dynamic than IDH mutant because their cellular state appear to be less stable over time. And so we wanted to actually quantify this, and we ask which rates do transition between this transcriptionally defined cell state might occur. And so to do this one, we borrow a mathematical framework that was canonically used in quantitative ecology to estimate migration between species across niches. And we adapted this maximum likelihood model and then basically try and ask and estimate now a migration across these different transcriptional cellular state. And then the model basically predicted that in GBM sample in the IDH wild type cases basically predicted a much significantly higher rate of dedifferentiation compared to IDH mutant. And so this basically would allow the replenishment of their stem-like cell compartment, not only through the classic pathway, which is self renewal, but also through de-differentiation from a more differentiated state to a more stem-like state. And this is not happening in IDH mutant, where we think this follow more the classical cancer unidirectional hierarchy, where you have the stem cell at the apex that then gives rise to all of the differentiated projects. And of course, this is a model. And so, now in the lab, we are trying to validate this data-driven model of plasticity through experimental and linear tracing assays in collaboration with Dr. Gelare-Zadeh. And more importantly, also, this allows us now to start engaging with some more clinically relevant questions. And the one that we are particularly interested in is, like, is this high degree of de-differentiation that we observe in the IDH wild-type cases potentially offering an additional mechanism by which this tumor could replenish their stem-like cell compartment under a specific therapeutic pressure? And so, shall we therefore moving away from targeting the classical stem-like cell compartment and rather inhibit or targeting more the cell state transition somehow? This is something that we are thinking about. We are currently expanding more on this work now in the lab by assessing how these diverse cellular states are changing in time after standard of care therapy. And this is again in collaboration with Dr. Zadeh. But importantly, something we are excited about is that we are also exploring cell state diversity now in space. And we are doing this one by sampling different anatomical regions within the same tumor and the tumor microenvironment. And the working hypothesis we have here is that infiltrating or glioma cells that are more at the edge of the tumor would be actually transcriptionally or perhaps epigenetically different than the one found more in the dense tumor core area. And this may be in part due to their interaction that they have with surrounding cells. And we just received back a first pilot single cell data sample where we are basically processing four different regions within the same tumor in a gradient from the tumor core to the tumor edge and then the normal brain cortex. And we are now in the process of basically doing the canonical single cell pipeline where we are trying to like annotate cell type and everything. And we are already seeing some diversity between the non-malignant and the malignant cases. So this is very fresh, but I hope next time I can give you a bit more on this one. So now, I'm kind of in this second part of the talk. I actually want to tell you that, understanding cancer cell composition and their molecular vulnerability is not the only thing we are interested in the lab. As a part of the new direction that we are trying to take here when we started here at Princess Margaret, is also try and use some of our multi-omic toolkit to answer the question of like what drives specific clonal expansion in human tissues or individuals that are at higher risk of malignant transformation. And yeah, just a little bit of background. Recent finding has basically shown this pervasive clonal expansion across many healthy human tissues, and these are mainly associated with aging. And so basically within a given healthy tissue, there is this extensive subclonal diversity, and this subclone may show phenotypic variability, which can be due to both genetic and non-genetic heterogeneity. And specifically in the context of hematopoiesis in the blood, this clonal expansion that harbors specific mutation They're basically called clonal hematopoiesis or CH. And although individuals with CH show normal peripheral blood count, they don't show any different clinical phenotype, they already have this higher risk of transforming and developing leukemia later on in life. And besides the most well-known mutation, there are also studies here by many groups in Toronto, including Sagi, Abelson, Philip, Awadalla, John Dick. We are an interesting splicing factor mutation, which are also associated with this higher risk of developing leukemia in the future. And so here, basically, we are interesting trial, like understanding what are the cell type specific changes that and the presence of SF31 a mutation, which is a core member of the spliceosome, basically conferred to this individual that have clonal hematopoiesis. And what we know is that SF31 a mutation actually promote recognition of alternative branch point along the RNA transcript, and this most commonly lead to a much higher basically usage of alternative 3' site, basically alternative splicing. But the actual study of mutant SF31-driven aberration directly from patient sample has been mainly hampered by two limitations. One is that it's very hard to distinguish mutant and wild-type single cell in this directly from the human patient sample, and especially the poor coverage of short read over this splicing junction. And so, here I just want to basically touch on this point, which is basically, the main, again, like challenges of studying this clonal expansion is the fact that they usually represent a mixture of mutant and wild-type cell, where the mutant cell are actually the very minority. And so we know by now that single-cell sequencing allow for the study of this distinct and also very rare population, but mutated cell are often morphologically and phenotypically similar to their wild-type counterpart. And so this, again, this limits our ability to extract signal that is coming directly from the mutant cell. And so here we basically ask a very simple question. Well, how do we study this? How can we directly link the presence of a few number of cells that carry specific mutation to changes in cellular phenotype? So to address this, basically we came up with a new multi-omic method that allow to capture now all from the same sample and at the single cell level, the transcriptome using short read sequencing, the mutational status of individual cell using a targeted genotyping approach, and also long read sequencing using Oxford Nanopore technology or ONT. And this now we think will allow us to investigate these cell type specific changes that are caused by the presence of this splicing factor mutation. And here I just want to make sure that we are all on the same page before I dive a little bit in the method and then the data. And I just want to touch on the differences between short and long read. And we know by now the short read-based single-cell RNA sequencing, especially the droplet-based methodologies, only yield information from a very small region at the end of one of the end of the transcript. And so this basically like preclude all of the type of analysis that many of us are interested in, such as splicing variant calling, isoform level, gene expression analysis, and so on. But in contrast, read basically has no really requirement for fragmentation. There's no really a read length limitation. And what we do is basically we sequence the entire cDNA molecule, and this enables a much higher in-depth analysis of alternative splicing directly in single cell. I put in here this slide, even if it's not really data-driven, because I want to sort of share a little bit of the struggle that we had to optimize all of this Oxford Nanopore pipeline, basically. So when we first start doing this, we noticed that only around, let's say, 40 to 50% of our total read pool actually had the full length read with the accurate structure. And so basically, the first few samples, we were wasting over half of every Nanopore flow cell by basically sequencing empty reads. And one of the reasons this is the case is because with Illumina short read, basically only read that have the correct structure and adapter edit will get sequenced. But with long read, basically anything and everything that is present in the library will get sequenced. And so through the years, we have been working with Oxford Nanopore team, which finally we were able to develop this biotin enrichment protocol, basically that allows for the selective enrichment of read that have now the full length structure. And I'm actually happy to say that this is now provided actually as a product by OMT. So you can now basically generate your full-length barcoding cDNA using your classical 10x genomics workflow, and then with some of the kit that now OMT provide, you can then sequence these on a PromethION and generate your long read library from the same sample. So after doing all of this type of optimization, which took a bit of time, we're happy to see actually that this single-cell full-length transcriptional profile were very comparable with short read sequencing. Indeed, we observed very high correlation in terms of UMI per cell, UMI per gene, and also gene per cell. And then, so but we wanted to then use this to actually accurately identify alternative splice junction. And so we develop an analytical pipeline basically that first uses basically the cell barcode and UMI information that are identified from the short read to then guide the assignment of the long read basically. And then the second part of the pipeline down the line is more the classical basically intron junction calling, annotation of this junction, and then the integration with the transcriptional and genotyping information. And this is again provided on GitHub if you want to take a look. And yeah, some comparison and advantages that we found by using our long read library. Basically, when we look at shared cover transcript and shared basically junction cluster, what we see is that almost a 12-fold increase in the number of junctions that were detected using full length compared to short read, and where almost 90% of the junctions that were identified from long read were actually not discovered by short read sequencing. And here is just another example where we basically highlight the discovery power of long read by comparing again short here in orange and long here in bluish, I guess, event in relation to the distance to the 3' end of every transcript. So if you take this is your 3' end, which generate various bins of different length, and then we ask, basically what's the coverage and how many junctions we can detect. And what we see is that basically a substantially greater number of junctions were detected along both the length of the transcript, but also overall compared to the short read library. And here is just like one simple example where you can see for this gene like PPOX, where you can start here from the 3'M, you can see how the coverage in short read really dropped very fast, while long read you have it along the whole transcript, and the cryptic 3' site we were interested in was almost at the opposite end, and we were still able to pick it up nicely. So this again, some advantages of using this workflow when you wanna ask questions around splices. And so here now that we have basically a protocol, a pipeline that allows us to integrate across all of these various layers that we are interested in, which are the genotype, transcriptome, and spliceosome, we can go back to some of the biology. And here I just want to show you one of the application. So here basically we apply this method to CD34 positive progenitor cell from cases with clonal hematopoiesis, which carry SF3B1 mutation. And so the first thing we did here was to use the short read sequencing to actually do classical clustering and identify the expected hematopoietic progenitor subset in a gradient from earlier hematopoietic stem cell and more differentiated erythroid progenitor cell or EP cell. And then we were also curious to making sure to exclude the presence of additional genetic lesion in this clonal hematopoiesis sample. And so we performed a copy number analysis using single cell RNA-seq. And what we found was no basically major chromosomal gain or losses, again, like acknowledging the many caveat of inferring copy number from single cell RNA-seq data, but it was a good internal validation for us to make sure that the CH cases only carry really the SF3B1 variant. And with the targeted genotyping library, what we can do is then we can overlay the genotype of every single cell to the transcriptomic data and start seeing basically if there is a preferential enrichment of mutant cell in a specific cell type. And what we see here is basically preferential enrichment of mutant cell that carry this SF3B1 mutation, mainly more differentiated cell types such as EP or megakaryocyte erythroid progenitor cell, which are basically more differentiated compared to the earlier hematopoietic stem cell. And so here, basically, this show that this clonal hematopoiesis cell already demonstrate this like lineage differentiation bias, which is actually a classical hallmark of more transformed disease such as myelodysplastic syndrome when this CH cell then like transformed. So this was quite interesting. With the type of data we generated, we can now do like de novo differential gene expression between SF3B1 mutant and SF3B1 wild type cell basically. And then here we show that some of the gene and gene pathways, such as translation, mainly were differentially upregulated in the mutant population. And this, again, is a typical hallmark for more transformed disease, such as, again, like MDS. And so this, again, suggests to us that there is this presence of conserved mutational impact mechanism that is already present at this very early pre-disease state. This is all done with the short read. So Let me get to the more interesting question that we wanted to ask by using the long read, which is, are these differentiation lineage biases that we see actually linked to specific changes in the splices? And so with our long read data, we can now look at all of the alternative three prime sites that are identified in our CH sample, and we can compare data PSI between mutant and wild type cell and think about the PSI is percent splice in. So it's basically a measure of how much a given alternative splice site has been used, thinking about as a fold change when you're doing differential gene expression. And so what we see here is a very big skew toward the right-hand side of this volcano plot. And this indicate that the mutant cell basically have a much higher frequency of using alternative splice site than wild type cell. What now also allow us to do is to go in and look for individual transcript that are preferentially impacted now when you have this SF3B1 mutation. And here I just show you another type of analysis that we can do, which is like mapping all of these mis-splicing events now along the continuous axis of differentiation rather than looking at binary group. And here we basically rank from the least differentiated to the most differentiated progenitor cell, and then ask and then compare mutant to wild type and found basically gene that were preferentially mis-spliced in the mutant cell. And one particular example that we came across that we are following up now is this Bax isoform. This was recently shown basically to confer anti-apoptotic properties to leukemia cell. And so we think this might actually confer a sort of survival advantage to the mutant cell. And this is something we are exploring now more in the lab in collaboration with Omar Abdel-Wahab at MSKCC. So here for this part, I just show you that basically we developed this multiomic single-cell method that now allows to integrate genotype and cell type to then try and examine how this come together to shape alternative splicing landscape, and that then leads to potential specific cellular phenotype. We applied it to this premalignant setting. In the preprint, we also applied it to more transformed cases of myelodysplastic syndrome. And this is a method that can be applied to any model if you have a question that is around specific mutation and alternative splicing or And so in the last two slide, I also want to tell you the very recent work also show that similar to clonal hematopoiesis, a mutation also accumulate with age in human B-cell. This was shown in two seminal work in the past year. But in contrast to clonal hematopoiesis, which is being studied by many group, now we have very little information directly from human sample about what are the mechanism through which mutation that canonically affect B-cell lymphomas actually confer this clonal advantage in healthy or let's say high risk population. And so in the lab now, we are currently trying to expand our work to use some of the approaches that I show you today to try and better define what is the molecular landscape of pathogenic B-cell in patients that are at higher risk of transforming to B-cell lymphomas. And so for doing this, we are collecting healthy sample and as well individuals that have autoimmune diseases, which is as we consider it sort of an intermediate stage along the spectrum from healthy to B-cell lymphomas. And this is we are setting up all of the workflow and infrastructure now in the lab, but this is mainly done in collaboration with the Toronto Lupus Program and John Deeks, Stephanie, and Steven Chen at PM. This is not really a data-driven, genomic data-driven slide, but it's just to show you that where we are at, we are generating proof of concept mainly and preliminary data to show and especially convince ourselves that we can detect a mutation in various B-cell subset. So we have designed an antibody panel that allow us to sort out various B-cell population and then test for the presence of specific mutation. This is again was a germline mutation, but we also now have whole exome data from the first pilot cohort of autoimmune disease sample, and I hope we have a list of mutation soon that will guide us basically which sample to pick for our single cell approach that I just showed you here. And so, yeah, to conclude, I just want to say that, you know, the couple of stories that I share with you today join kind of the bigger vision that we have here in the lab, which is actually to try and integrate genetic, epigenetic, and transcriptional information in the study of cancer evolution. And we are trying to do this at the single cell level resolution, which is more the raw fundamental evolutionary unit. And yeah, with this, I really would like to conclude and really thank the amazing team that have been helping to set up the lab in this first year. A collaborator at Yue Chen and medical biophysicist at U of T, member of my postdoc mentor lab, Dan Landau in New York, Oxford Nanopore team, funding that we were able to support and kick off some of this research. And I'm recruiting postdoc. If you find any interest, let me know. And thanks so much for listening, and happy to take any questions.